Week 19 of my coronavirus log. See below for timestamps and descriptions. Saturday, July 18th, day 125 of the quarantine. Today I'm going to walk you through something I do every year. Now, when there's not a global pandemic, what I normally like to do, my two favorite activities is go to concerts or shows and go to Yankee games, both down at Yankee Stadium where I have a season ticket package for all the Saturday home games, and go on the road. And I'm trying to hit every major league ballpark, you know, and check them all off, visit all of them. I've hit a bunch of them, and I'll share those details with you, but there's still a bunch I haven't hit. And one caveat to that, I just don't want to go see, you know, the Royals play the Tigers or something like that. I want to see the Yankees play in that ballpark. And as far as shows, just to give you an idea of how many, I usually go to a couple of shows a week in a normal schedule. Last year, in 2019, I went to 80 concerts, and not just locally, but also traveling for festivals. And for Yankee games, I usually hit trying to do one or two road trips a season. Last year, it was one, but that one was to London. So that was kind of a big one. So because time and money, two resources, are always scarce, and I'm always preaching to my daughter, hey, the definition of economics is reconciling unlimited wants with limited resources and how to allocate those resources. So I go through an exercise every year to figure out how I'm going to allocate my resources to best accomplish what I want to do to determine which road trip I'm going to take to see the Yankees. So I'm going to walk you through it. I get it. I'm completely OCD. You're going to roll your eyes at this, but I get a kick out of it, especially sitting here doing it when I can't go anywhere, especially while I'm waiting on the goddamn COVID test to still come back. So I'm not even going to the grocery store or running to Stewart's or anything. It's kind of nice to go through this and be like, oh, where do I want to travel next summer? Assuming that all this shit will be over. So here's my ballpark bucket list. Even though there's 30 major league teams, I've actually got a total of 35 stadiums on here, simply because you've had teams build new stadiums, like the Yankees, old Yankee Stadium, new Yankee Stadium. That's two opportunities for stadiums. And so a lot of teams I've actually seen the old ballpark, like Texas or the Braves. I've been to the old ballpark, but I have not been to the new one. So those count as unchecked boxes, I guess you'd say. So I've been to 21 total stadiums out of the 35. So I'm about two-thirds of the way there, 60%. Plus, I've been to ballparks, four ballparks overseas. Two in Japan, one in Korea, and then the aforementioned London game with the Yankees and Red Sox. So I'm just working through this list. So here's the Yankee schedule for 2021. 162 games, 81 on the road. That's 26 road series to pick from. So when you get 26 potential road trips, you know, it helps me to narrow it down, take a look at it and say, what's important to me? So what I do, and it's something I developed in the Army, or that I got used to using in both in the Army and corporate America, is a decision matrix where you establish the criteria you want and then you rank order each choice by that criteria. So I use six criteria. One, is it a new ballpark? It is something that I have not crossed off my bucket list. Two, is it cool? I.e., not necessarily the ballpark, but is it someplace I want to go? Sorry, Cleveland, but Miami ranks higher than Cleveland as far as visiting. So that's just kind of an intangible and kind of my own personal thing. Can I visit multiple stadiums? So is it something where I can hit this stadium and that stadium? So take one trip and knock out two ballparks. Is it on a weekend? Hell, a lot easier to go on a weekend than it is during the week. You don't have to take vacation, et cetera, at least not as much vacation. Friends, do I have friends or family there that I can end up seeing, possibly stay with, and just catch up with? You know, that's something versus just going and not knowing anybody. I usually travel with my friends Frank and Lori, who have the same ticket package as me, and every year we go through this as well. And then lastly, how affordable is it? Like I said, got to reconcile those limited resources, not only time, but money, with where I end up going and how many trips I can take. So what I'll do is I'll get the schedule out, import it into a slide, and then I highlight all the road trips and I assign each road trip a number. Then what I will do is throw it into a spreadsheet and go through, do a rank ordering with five being the highest score, one being the lowest score for each of the categories we mentioned, and then take a look and sort it and see what it looks like. So I went through and did the exercise, and Miami came out on top because it maxed out at five out of the six criteria. It's a new ballpark, pretty cool place to go, although it'll be hot in July. I can hit multiple stadiums because if I go down, might as well hit Tampa Bay right before that. So flying to Tampa, see that game, then go to Miami. It's over a weekend. I've got friends there because my friends Frank and Lori that I talked about that go with me on these things and have the same season ticket package. We have a place in Miami. And the only thing it doesn't end up getting is it's 3 out of 5 as far as affordability because I can crash with them. So I won't end up being out for a hotel room. So we'll look at that. And then the other one, so I mean, a West Coast trip to hit both Oakland and the Angels would be great to do. Got to look at that and say, can I do both a Florida trip and a West Coast trip? Again, that scores pretty well. And then it gets down into, you know, individual games that are relatively more affordable. See how much time we've got. It'd be nice to hit either Cleveland or Detroit. I can't do Detroit, even though it scored well, because I've got a conflict that weekend. I'm supposed to see Boston Calling, but it'd be great to see that. And then I got friends in Houston. I could see it. I'd go see the Yankees play the Astros, but I've been there. Same thing with Baltimore. Same thing, I got family in Philly. Always fun to do a day trip out to Boston or go down and see the Mets, you know, when the Yankees are at Citi Field. So I'll have to make some choices here. But this is what it looks like, and this is the basis at least to start discussing it and start doing some planning and taking a look at what road trips might take next year. This is the crazy process I use.
It is so nice to be watching baseball again, even though it's just exhibition. Red Thunder going deep. It is weird. All the freaking cutouts there, nobody in the stands.
Watching a game on monitors from Citi Field, and that's the new world as visiting television has to do the game either from a studio or from their home ballpark.
Just sitting here listening to Big Audio Dynamite and drinking coffee. This Mick Jones from The Clash. And this was a huge song when I was, at least for me, when I was in college, maybe, junior, senior year. And this just takes me back. This, along with the Spin Doctors, takes me back to my spring break, my senior year. So just such a good song. And I guess Joe Strummer actually ended up collaborating with Big Audio Dynamite with Mick Jones, even after the breakup of The Clash. So anyways, just listening to WEQX's Rewind, where they go back and listen to a bunch of old school songs. When I repay you handsomely, broken hearts are hard to mend, nor have my share.
Situation I'll win. Rush for a change of atmosphere. I can't go on, so I give in. Gotta get myself right out of here. Situation I'll win. Rush for a change of atmosphere. I can't go on, so I give in. Gotta get myself right out of here.
So this is Ellen Krauss, young Swedish artist, who was on my short list of favorites for South by Southwest that unfortunately got canceled. Let's give her a listen.
Without people not approving of.
you for calling Minute Clinic. There is currently an extremely high demand for COVID-19 tests due to the increase in cases in certain parts of the country. This has caused backlogs for our lab partners who are responsible for processing the samples collected at CBS locations. As a result, it may take 6 to 10 days for people to receive their results, and in some instances, our lab partners may take longer to return the results. Our lab partners are working hard to address this issue. When your test result is ready, you will receive an email with a link to your MyChart account. We appreciate your patience and again, apologize for this delay. We are experiencing significant call volume and wait times. We apologize for this inconvenience.
So I've been on hold 17 minutes so far trying to get through to somebody to talk to. Yeah, hi, Ashley. Craig McAvoy here. How are you this morning?
Good, and you?
I'm well. Hey, I'm calling because I know COVID test results are delayed, but it's been 2 weeks since I took my test. So just calling to see if there's, I've been checking my chart and stuff like that. Just calling to check on the status of it and when I could expect it and make sure there wasn't something broken. And I guess, what information do you need from me?
So I need your first and last name and your date of birth.
Okay, it's Craig McAvoy. That's M-C...
Okay, so it looks like they're still working on yours. They have received them, but we haven't got them back yet.
Okay. Boy, that's taken a lawfully long time, especially for New York where we don't have it as bad. But I guess I guess nationally it's impacting everywhere. Okay. So I guess just keep checking. I mean, because I know it says an average of, that it was 2 to 4 when I took it. Now it's, I think, 6 to 10, but here I am at day 14.
Yeah, unfortunately, the only thing we can do is just keep checking back. We're just kind of playing a waiting game now, unfortunately.
Okay. But it shows in the system. It's not like it got lost or anything like that. So it's just a matter of just sit tight, I guess. Luckily, I'm not showing any symptoms, but I want to make sure I'm not asymptomatic and start going around and spreading it,
No, you're fine. And it does show that it is active and they are working on it.
Okay. Well, I'll keep checking then and I'll look for that email. So thank you. I at least wanted to confirm that it didn't get lost in the mail somewhere. So.
Yeah, no, you're fine.
Okay, great. Ashley, thank you very much for the update. And I'll just keep waiting.
You're welcome and you have a good day.
Thanks a lot. You too. Bye-bye. There we go. It's not done yet. At least they haven't lost it, though. So in COVID news, there's some encouraging news coming out of a study at the University of Oxford for a vaccine. Let's hope that comes through. And then Trump finally encourages people to put a mask on. Of course, he still calls it the China virus. God, what a fucktard. So this is great. There's this 10-year-old kid in the UK that has started as a project for the pandemic, his own music zine. So his own music magazine. So I saw it on the Fontaines DC fan page because he did an interview with Carlos. So I went on Bandcamp and bought actually both the issues that he's got out there, sent him a note just saying, hey, good for you, kid. Kind of a note of encouragement. And I signed it. It's like, hey, here's an old punk to a young punk. So I actually just came in the mail, and overnight I saw that the BBC picked up the news story. So it's kind of blowing up and gone viral. Just saw a post on Facebook from him that he's getting interviewed by radio stations all over the place. Just kind of a feel good story. And looking forward to reading the magazine itself. Wednesday, July 22nd, finally, after 16 days of waiting, got my COVID test results back, and not surprisingly, they were negative, but at least now it's confirmed and I'm done with it. I'm shocked how long it took. It seems like everybody else's were a lot faster. I mean, the average I've been hearing is 4 to 6 days, but it's still over and done with. Started off the morning, there's this artist that I've talked about in previous weeks, Caitlin Keegan, who's been doing a live stream every Wednesday night in Melbourne, which is 6 a.m. New York time. So she's just got a great voice. And then came across Ellie Barter, another Australian with a phenomenal voice. She did a version of her song Girly Bits with a woman by the name of Eileen Sparks on cello. And it's really freaking good. Just take a listen. So last week for Quarantine Vinyl, I played Black Flag. Going to switch it up quite a bit this week and go with The Muppet Movie and Rainbow Connection, which is on the album, the vinyl that had been stored in my sister's basement that I'd been going through. So this is going to be the first time I've actually left the house or been in the car in 17 days since I was waiting on that damn test. So all I'm going to do is run to Stewart's and get some milk, but still, it's good to be out.
From Amazon.
Let's open this up. Got on eBay that is from the Maydol Hammer Factory, which is a factory that was originally in my hometown. Let me get this unwrapped. So that was wrapped up tape pretty good. So again, this is a hammer from the Maydol Hammer Factory, which is Hammer Factory, a forge house. It was in my hometown of Norwich, New York. And I will provide some more details, but you can see right there where it says that. Maydol. So I got this on eBay for, I think it was like 10 bucks or something like that. But I collect historical stuff, so I thought this would be a nice addition to it. Still in great shape. So Madol Hammer was founded by David Madol in 1843 in Norwich, New York. And what he discovered is a better way to keep the hammer from flying off the handle. So it was a better design. It was founded along the Shenango Canal in downtown Norwich. And I've actually got a map from 1855 that you can see where it lists the hammer factory there. And you can see it right along the canal there. And it just says Hammer Factory. The whole deal was, hey, this is, I don't make good hammers, I make the best hammer. And it operated from 1843 all the way up until the late 1950s. It got contracts during World War II for hammers for the Navy, etc. And then finally, there was a fire in 1957, and it went out of business. There's still a Madol Street in Norwich. It just doesn't happen to be where the actual factory was. So pretty neat. I like having it. All right, it is Amazon subscribe and save week, so I'm going to have a bunch of stuff showing up. Birdseed. And this, I believe, might be the most important delivery of the month. Yes, coffee to wake me up in the morning, melatonin to make me go to sleep at night. Oh, nice. This is my, all the watches I've been getting. Needed to get a new watch box. All right, creamer. An awfully big box here. Dog food. Oh shit, they put my filters in with it, which beats the shit out of the filters. Oh, nice. This is the CDs that I ordered from the Irish band that I was talking about, Sons of the Southern Ulster, who I'm actually trying to connect them with the local radio station. So they sent me both the one I ordered, as well as an extra one to send to WEQX, and they threw in their debut as well. Nice of them. So good sounding band. All right. Actually partially open, so don't make it cut it. I think I know what this is. I think this is the Trio watch. Oh no, this is the Pagani. This is actually one of the ones I ordered from China. So, got a cloth there. And there's the actual watch. I'll do a deeper dive into this. All right, so let's take a look at this Pagani. This is the Pagani Explorer. Pagani's a Chinese OEM watchmaker. They're known for making quote-unquote homages to more expensive watches, which is homage is just another word for a knockoff. Now, it's different than the counterfeit watches. Now, I've been to China, and you can buy a counterfeit Rolex or a counterfeit Tag, and I have, I must admit, in some of the markets over there that are meant to replicate. These are just meant to mimic. And this Pagani Explorer is meant to mimic the Rolex Submariner. I saw a review on it by the guy from Just One More Watch, and he recommended it's a great deal on AliExpress. And it's an $80 watch, you know, trying to mimic an $8,000 watch. So the box itself, nothing fancy here, as you can tell. You see the logo there on the top, pretty flimsy. It's got its own little Pagani label cloth there. I've already taken the packaging off of this, so I'll take this out, give you a closer look. I'm not going to go as in depth as I have on other things there. Clean that off a little bit. But when you take a look at it, it's got a 40 millimeter diameter case. It's pretty thick, 13 millimeters thick.
I don't have the measurements for a lug to lug, but otherwise it really does mimic the Submariner. You got a round case here. It's got a sapphire crystal, raised indicators. If you look there, those are raised there at each hour. It's got this It's got this textured bezel here, unidirectional. And actually, you can hear that. It's actually got a nice sound to it. Get that back up at the top. Got the Pagani at the top. And then you've got, let me pull this out. It's a diver, so you unscrew this, pull this out, and then you can see it mimics the same sort of dial design that you've got on the Rolex automatic. It's water resistant to 100 meter. You've got the date complication there with a little window. Nice bracelet, steel oyster bracelet. It's got the Pagani logo on the, I don't know if you can see that that well. On the crown, it's got a Seiko NH35 movement. At the end of the day, it's like, shit, $80 for a nice automatic watch is not a bad deal. As far as the bracelet, it's got pretty sturdy. It's got a good feel to it. So open this up. I tried it on. I'm going to actually have to adjust it. One thing, the bracelet was a little tricky because I had to take some links out. So this is something I haven't run into before, but these actually, you end up unscrewing this and there's a little connection down to the bottom, and then you have to pull the link out. So that's something that was a little different. Well, here it is on my wrist. Once I took that link out, it fits nice. And what you can kind of see here, there you go, is it's blue on top, but then you get down to the bottom, it's actually black. So I like that combination there. All right, another watch today. This is from Triwa Microband, and I just could not resist getting this watch. It's called the Comb Over. Triwa is a Swedish micro brand. I've actually got another watch coming from them. This is freaking phenomenal. Look at this. So it's "We Shall Overcome," and you'll get an idea why that is here when you see the watch itself. So those are the hands, are basically the comb over hair. I saw this and I'm like, oh shit, I cannot not buy this. So take a look at the back here as well. "Together We Shall Overcome." Oh my God, this is great. Actually, nice little symbol on the crown as well. Really thin. Take this off here. Oh my God, I love this. Kind of surprised how they shipped it like this. Normally it comes in something more protected, like a cardboard. So Beach Boys pets, I was trying to get some of the more essential stuff in my collection that I didn't already have. That's it for the week. Hopefully you enjoyed seeing the crap I got. Baseball opening night. I am excited about this. I know I won't be able to go down and watch the games. I know it's a crazy 60-game series with all sorts of weird rules and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, I get to watch Yankee baseball. So we got Garrett Cole going against Max Scherzer down in D.C. Really hope the Yankees win. Just excited to see baseball.
Through a postseason, here we go. Forget his gritty performance in Game 7 of the World Series.
Yes,
and
we have baseball.
Is under one.
Man, I've been waiting for this.
Last season, Cole was the only one who changed.
Oh, come on, Cole.
Friday,
July 24th, day 131 of the quarantine. Yankees won last night, shortened game. It was just nice to watch freaking baseball and see Garrett Cole pitch. I just forget how much what a fan I am. I was pissed at it earlier when they had all the contract strifes and stuff like that. Fuck you, baseball. But I'm just so goddamn glad it's back. I still wish I could go down, do my normal routine to see the game, but it is what it is. So it definitely will help going through with all the limited activities that are out there, not being able to go to shows, not being able to travel, not being able to meet friends out for drinks and stuff like that, which they're starting to limit, you know, loosen the limits on that. I'm just not comfortable with it yet. It's just too much out there. I mean, there's still no vaccine. So to me, nothing's changed. So I'm definitely taking more conservative than other people, but hope everybody has a great weekend.